All right, let's pray then, we'll get started.
It has a little thing in the back if you want it to go.
Thing in the back?
Yeah.
Push button.
I think that's a busted button.
Oh.
Okay, anyway, let's pray. Yeah, we're fighting it, all right. Thank you, Lord, for today, we thank you for your word, we thank you for the opportunity to study it, we thank you for allowing us to be part of mercy and grace in your marvelous program. Allow us to study, Lord, in such a fashion that it remains embedded in us, we don't forget it, we save what to be saved, and we use what's to be used when we walk out of this room, so that we have, without a doubt, picked up something from you that enriches our lives, allows the Holy Spirit to direct us a little bit better, and we listen a little bit closer. And in doing so, Lord, we honor and glorify you and your Son. We ask these things in his name. Amen. Amen. All right. There you go. I think you might like that one if it's voting time. The Bible teaches righteousness. This is Dikaiosune. Okay, this is the one that tells you that you have picked up the essences of God, you've got parts of him. It does not teach you have any rights. None.
You ceded those rights.
And?
As if you had any in the first place.
Exactly. So the thing about it is if you're listening to somebody that tells you you have a right to do something, turn your ears off. It is not useful to you at all to take in rotten information. Rotten things grow all the time. How many times has anybody kicked the mushrooms in your yard? Okay, why do you do that, you vicious people? Because I like to see the spores go everywhere, all right? Or I like the little round ones, and when I step on them, it goes, okay? Yes, sir.
Can we get the right to tell the devil to go to hell?
No.
Or at least you, get out.
No. Not particularly. Well, you can tell him to leave if you want, but...
Resist the devil and he will flee from you.
Resisting the devil has nothing to do with words. How do I resist the devil? How do I resist? And I'm serious about this. All you need to do is have a thought in your head that's scripture, and he hears it. He knows it. Why? Because when you start verbalizing that, anything, that's information for him to use. Okay? If you want to use some words and you want to make him leave, you say, I belong to Jesus Christ. You can stop right there. Okay? Because the more you get embroiled, you know what you're trying to do? You're trying to debate the best debater that ever hit the planet. He has a comeback for every statement you can make. He even tried to out-debate Jesus Christ. Now, do you see why I'm saying that? Don't go into that field. All right? You're going to have enough entertainment with his minions without ever inviting it. It is truly not necessary. If you want to see him flee from you, then you tell him you're under the blood of Jesus Christ. That is going to ruin his day. That is all the more statement you have to make. And then you extricate yourself from the situation and you don't entertain it anymore. That's why when the lady was on the ground in front of Christ, he never said one word about her sins. He said, get up and... What did he say to her?
Sin no more.
Sin no more. He did not say what the sin was. Okay? He didn't need any of that. He just said, go and walk away from that particular position and do not entertain it anymore. Okay? So that's what I'm saying. You don't need rights when you have the supreme being of the universe patrolling your neighborhood all the time. You do not need them. And you have to realize that any scenario that comes into your life, any scenario, he already knows about it. He's already made provisions for it. He's already put you through it in the scenario little machine that he has, and he knows what the outcome's going to be. All you have to do is put yourself in his hands so that you come out the other side exactly the way he intended for you to come out. What education you needed, what evidence you needed, what experiential program you had to have inserted in your head so you don't do it again, all of those things are right there put together in that program. You are exceedingly special to him. I find that more and more and more. That me meddling really messes up the neighborhood. Okay? There you go. Now, all for a little saving. Now, here's the deal. Where were we at? We were the creatures, right? Yep.
67.
You put my eyeball. Hang on. 67?
Yeah.
Okay. Alright, hang on. Anybody heard from the Twists? Seen them anywhere? I'm going to give them a holler. And the Wellmans? I know they travel a lot, so that one I'm not so concerned about. The Twists, I'm just curious. You saw them in church? Okay. I just want to make sure. I mean, it's not like I don't have the ability to say something to tick somebody off. So. If they leave for that reason, that's okay. I don't mind. I don't want them to think that I'm aware of it. That may not change it, but I'm aware of it. Okay. So, just so you know how the show goes. All right. I'm going to start at 20 so that we can catch up here. Romans 1, 20. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world. Okay, now, I want you to understand what we're at today is creature. Okay. We start out. Oops. There's the venue you're working with. Creation and creature. And it says, creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even the eternal power and the Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Those that do not believe are without excuse. Because that, when they knew God, all right, here's your deal. This is so that everybody in planet Earth realizes that there is never a time on your timeline in your life that you are not aware of the existence of God. Never. You may not write it in your cereal in the milk in the morning. You may not write it on the board at home. You may not write it on a piece of paper. But your entity, your ability, your internal parts know that something puts you together and know that there's something out there greater than you. That's what they're saying. That's why it says all right? And then when they knew God, they glorified him not. All right? We already worked through that stuff. Neither were they thankful, but became vain in their own imaginations. Their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. And fools, we already established, is a moronic lifestyle. It is a lifestyle pre-ignorance. Does that make sense? You don't even have to know about it to not know about it. That's how you're put together. So it is a blessing to be ignorant. Just in case you wanted to know why. It can be fixed. Okay? Contrary to Ron White, stupid can be fixed. You got a wrinkle in your brow there.
I'll say ignorance can be fixed. Stupidity is sometimes...
Well, let's put it this way. At least you have a project. Okay? And you have to understand, if you're working on God's side of the spectrum, there is not a marker anywhere along the line that says you do not have the mental capacity to understand God. Okay, nowhere along the line does it ever say that. That's why he can extend the invitation to everybody. So you just have to look at it that way. Alright? Excuse me. And it says, and if their foolish hearts were darkened, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image like to corruptible man, and to birds, and to four-footed beasts, and to creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to unclean. Uncleanness is kind of a nice word. Perversion is probably a better word. Okay. Okay, and understand something. There is no way that you can draw a picture that would really give you a good exhibit of what the heart is. It really looks like. Okay, I don't think I've ever seen anybody ever put a picture together that could be that vile and that disgusting.
You've
and
been
that.
Lust over a lot of things.
Sure. Oh yeah.
Or somebody else has.
Exactly.
Been a lust
oodles. So I'm just saying, it's a never-ending program as far as that goes, all right? And so, and it says, wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves. So, after that it says, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator? All right? So that also tells you that they've made a conscious choice. They realize there is a Creator, and they're going to take the creature over the Creator. Once again, you've eliminated the thing. Well, I just don't know. I didn't know there was a God. Well, he dispels that with words like this. So, and then after that it says, who, talking about the Creator, is blessed forever. Now, I need you to pay attention to something. You and I don't realize that this creator thing is going on in spades everywhere around you. Okay? Anybody ever planted a garden? Yeah, isn't that fun? What else comes up beside the veggies?
Weeds.
The weeds, why?
That was their house
first. Yes, it was their house first. Okay, there you go. So you're an interloper. Okay. The deal is, you need to pay attention to this battle that goes on everywhere. How many of you have gone in? Anybody walk in the woods anymore? When you see a tree that's fallen over and it's fallen over for a period of time, what does it do? It rots away. It decays. But not only does it decay, it generates life for a lot of different organisms. Okay? And you have to realize that that's the battle. There's life and there's death, and then there's new life and good life and bad life and all that kind of stuff. So that's what. That's the deal that's going on here when it comes to creation and creator. I can acknowledge the creation by knowing the creator, but I can also disavow the creator by putting more emphasis on the creation than I do the creator. Trying to think of the guy's name. I don't remember whether it was Gothard or one of the guys. Used to be, everything flowed from God down to man. All right? You see that in your Father of Lights, rain down on me, all that kind of hoop that they fly around all the time. Here's the other one. Now, this is how this, but the God is not this God. The God is this God right here being used in creation. So now it has to go this way, and creation elevates man. How does it do that? Man thinks he has something to do with what's going on around him. So he can automatically elevate himself. Are you smarter than the worm? You hope so? Well, we'll have a family forum here after we're done. Okay, we'll check that out. And because that's the only kind of silly rationale that they can put together to work this program out.
Yeah, but you know, a worm has like many ganglions inside them that they're actually better for reaction and nervous system and movement than
yeah.
Bear.
How do you move a worm? No, I didn't say throw them. Okay. How do you move a worm? Take a vibrating tool of some kind.
Oh, vibrating.
I didn't say torture the worm. I said move them. And if you like, if you take like a, anybody know what a palm sander is?
Yes.
Okay. You got that? And we're not going to sand the hide off the worm. All right. All you do is you put the palm sander on the ground and turn it on. Ah, see? See, you're already in the same neighborhood I am. That's scary, but you'll be there for a minute. And what she said, these ganglion pick up the vibrations in the earth and they automatically move it away from the vibration. Okay? That's how you move them out of an area.
Another way is to get the worm, cut it in half, send both halves in the same direction and let them have a race.
Thank you, Donald. You need to get a second job.
That's
you got
what
way
I
too much doing. Time on your hands there sometimes.
That's actually what I was doing with that big spear out there.
Yeah, right. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Does that work for the bad worms in your garden eating your plants?
No, it doesn't work on nematodes, by the way. I've tried that. I'm sorry. I even thought about going to get one of those concrete jukes, you know, where you put the rod into the concrete, put it like this and make the concrete settle out. I thought about sticking that in the ground to make the bugs go away, but they don't do it. After a while they get used to it and then they just hang around and eat more. So, but at any rate, just need to pay attention to what he's actually saying here with this creation and creator thing. It's a constant battle that we're working with. Now, when you lay this out and you talk about this when you get to Romans, you need to talk about who you're dealing with. And that's what we're going to do here for the next couple pages, all right? Creature worship is a source of reversionism and evil. And we need to realize that anytime you see the word reversionism in the Bible, and it's because it's a theme term, but it means rebellion, lawlessness, which is evil. Okay, you're going to see terms like that, all right? So you need to realize that this is what's going on. Anybody that does not want to know about God is averting from the idea. They're getting away from what is to be done, and they want to do what they want to do. So, if you worship any creature, you worship Satan. Okay? Now you have all the animal lovers and all the tree huggers and all of these people. You need to delineate between somebody that is just passionate about something, which is not harmful. Okay.
Respect.
Do you know anything about Johnny Appleseed? He was a real guy. Why did he do what he did back in the 1700s and 1800s? Why did he do that?
He liked apples.
Because as people moved to the West, they cut down every moving branch that could be used as a building implement or house, and he went along feeling that this needed to be rectified, so he put them in the ground. Everywhere he went, he took seedlings and he got it started again. All right, these are people that have a genuine concern for what's going on. Okay, Joseph Murr. Okay, Ansel Adams. These photographers and these people that were involved in Yosemite and all the other parks need to understand they had a desire in their heart to maintain, and you can go to their words, the beauty that God established. Okay, they weren't out to lunch.
They're more stewards, if you will.
Bingo. Very much so. They had been impressed upon them that this was something that was important to man and important to God. He put it together for a reason. And I mean, if you can't stand in Yosemite and see God, you need to have your lenses checked. Okay? Period. So, at any rate, that's what they're talking about. So, you're going to worship Satan if you go beyond that point, though. You can't get wrapped up in that. Now, here's what you're going to be working with. It says, the person of the creature, Lucifer, son of the morning, most beautiful creature ever to come from the hand of God, most perfect, most intelligent, every great attribute that had ever been put into a form of creation. Okay? Never has there ever been another one like them. You have to understand, that does not include Christ. Why? He is not a creation. So don't let anybody crisscross those little puppies in the old barnyard, because that's not, you know, that doesn't work. His creature was given something to do, and his job at the time, I didn't put it down here, his job at the time was to walk in the garden that God created on this planet, or wherever else it could have been to. I have no clue. He just says he had some place that he had authority over, and he walked through this garden. All right? But in doing so, he ended up having a little too much of himself. How? I don't know. It's not given to us. We haven't got a clue. All right? But this creature became the ruler of angels that followed his program. All right? Prehistoric super creature of creatures, light years ahead of Adam, perfect human, who was Adam, okay, but inferior to the supreme creature. Adam couldn't hold a candle to Satan. Why? He could have, had he stayed in his position. He abdicated his position in his fall, and henceforth lost his status. Alright? Now, with all the rest of the stuff, you've got Isaiah and Ezekiel, which talks about all of his program, alright, what happened to him. Never in history has a creature such as this existed at any time. There are not even any Greek mythology creatures, any of that, any of those things that they brought into being with their writings. There's nothing that matches this. At least not that I can find in any books. Okay? And the big scholars haven't found it either, so. At any rate, the creature, enamored by his own genius, beauty, and ability, which inevitably led to unparalleled greatness. Okay? Always does. How many of you are impressed with yourself? Cowards.
I mean, sometimes.
Sometimes, yeah.
I mean, exactly. I did something.
Please understand
good
something.
Something to be proud of.
Your ego is not bad.
There's a good kind of pride and a bad
yeah,
kind of pride.
There you go. You need to delineate, because there are some of these people that think, well, that's just, if you do any of that stuff, you're automatically going to the pits of hell. Well, that's not what it is. He put that in you. Why? Because when you do things that are in him, it is a glorification process in you. You're going from glory to glory to glory as you learn to mature. And that's what he's talking about as far as that. Now, here's the deal. And it says, with all of that ignorance and arrogance, excuse me, for only the creature said, I will be God. Okay? And not only he didn't want to be God, he wanted to be higher than God. All right? So you can understand he kind
of
got
part of the problem of the rebellion, that we will eventually rule and reign, and the mm-hmm. angels will not. So mm-hmm. we actually superseded.
Correct.
This magnificent creature.
Correct. And the thing of it is in that magnificent creature, you're more so. Because what you will have accomplished by eternity is something that no other entity on planet Earth has ever, 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 ever accomplished. And that's belief in Christ without ever seeing the first physical sign of him to do that. Okay? You amaze the angels. Every time you respond to mercy and grace. Every time. Okay? No other entity in the universe has that ability, and it will stop the moment you see the face of Christ in the sky. It will be done. That program will pass off. A new one will be instituted through the tribulation and then through the millennium. Okay? We don't know all the wheres and why-fors of eternity, but that's just what they're talking about. So there was a conspiracy, a revolution, a revolt in the angelic conflict, but this creature did not succeed. All right? Bad thing that he did is he got a memo to himself that said, I will succeed, and that's the only one he reads every day. He doesn't read into the fact that he was cast out of heaven, not permanently, but cast out of heaven as his residence. Okay? He didn't read that as being a failure. So, at any rate, three falls of the creature have got him in Isaiah and Ezekiel, and all three falls are mentioned in the Revelation 12 and 20. All right? Understand, he fell when he was cast out of heaven with the demons that followed him. Number two, what's the card you have to get on the cape?
Oh, your badge.
Your badge, okay. Now, you just have to show it to get, well, no, right. Probably yeah. Don't anymore after they know your faith, but you need to show it to get into certain places, right?
Right.
I mean, you don't go in without it. But you will be immediately, what's that?
You always show it.
Oh, there you go, there's old school. I mean, that's what I always heard. You had to show it to get in somewhere.
You got to show it. They check your expiration date on the back.
Okay. Sure. All right. There you go. So Lois hasn't expired yet. Okay. That's a good thing. Okay. So just when you get a new card every now and again to update something or whatever. Here's the deal. He had a card. He slipped it into the little Gijahachi at the gate. And it said, yep, come on in. And then one day, in Revelation 12, he slipped his card in and he didn't get a green light. What did he get? Got the red light.
A call from security.
That's right. Need a couple of big angels over here. Got a guy trying to get in. See? Now he was cast out again. Two. Third fall. What would that be? Pay attention. What would that be? What would his last fall be? They're going to put this big throne together called the Great White Throne. And he's going to be pulled out of someplace. He's going to be pulled out of his holding cell. He's going to be standing before God. And he's going to ebbet out of here again. Now he's gone into Gehenna. Gone into the hot box forever. Three times he was cast out. Never did get the picture. I'll guarantee you, on his way to hell, you know what he's going to be saying? I'll be back. I'm going to win this thing. You guys can't do this to me. I have rights. Well, you just stew on them puppies for a while, okay? Tell me how that's working for you. Because that's just not the way the program's put together. All right? Now, two advents of the super creature. Garden program. This is when he came onto the scene. Nobody knew about him prior to that. And when he came on, it was a perfect environment. Garden was slicker than a whistle. Okay? I can't imagine. And a creature revolts against God. What did he do? Talked to the creation of God in Adam and destroyed that. And then shortly there, and after that, what happened after that? All kinds of things cascaded from that point on, all the way till Christ came and had a way to fix it. Now, the next part, end of the millennium. Perfect environment once again. You have to understand, millennium's going to be sweet. Earth is going to be normal. The only thing abnormal is going to be humans walking on it with a sin nature. Okay? Which is going to clarify once again in the mind of man, but he won't always understand it, that it's not environment that scrambles your program. It's you. Okay? That's what they're talking about. Millions of creatures are going to revolt against God. And these are people that are going to revolt against God that can see the living Christ. Okay? That's a dumb critter right there. Alright? So, creature is central antagonist in the angelic conflict. You can find that in Hebrews. You find it in Genesis. What do you find in Genesis? This is your giant neighborhood. Okay? You realize the giants were real, don't you? You know where your mythology came from? Those guys. These guys are written of again and again in mythology. Why? Because the demons that were chunked out of heaven cohabitated with women that were walking planet Earth and produced a race of big boys. Ever see Bubba that comes out of South Carolina every now and again? See him in some of the movies? The sucker must be 6'6", 320 or 30 pounds, fills up an ever-loving door hole, and doesn't have the brain capacity of a termite? That's what you're looking at. Okay?
How come those angels have the ability to reproduce?
I think angels have the ability to reproduce, but do not need to reproduce. But when you get down here and you're not in your position, I think reproduction is a byproduct of that shooting match. Because what does it say? They wanted to look on the...
You got it in Scripture.
Yeah, go ahead. What's it say? Scout it up there, Hoss. You have to understand, when they get down here to planet Earth, anything that was controlled by setting in heaven is no longer. It's unrestrained. How do you ever have an opportunity to set your Christianity aside and actually see you for you? I don't have that ability.
Look at our head. It didn't look like it was the right one.
Keep looking, boss. Mm-hmm. When you find it, give us a holler. Okay?
So the angels that come down here never go back up, right?
The angels that fell never got, they don't have access. I mean, let's put it this way. They can go up when Satan goes up and goes to the throne room. How do we know that?
Job.
Remember the conversation they had with Job? Well, there's other conversations in other places. And there is actually a conversation, I don't remember whether it's in, Chronicles.
One of the
older books where there is, God is sitting there and said, I need somebody to go put the lie into the king's head.
Oh, yeah, that
is. Okay? And believe me, this is the weirdest thing. That demon in heaven goes, pick me. Yeah. And God says, okay, you go do it. So the system is in progress. It's always working. That program up there is living out down here. And when he does that, how do you think do you realize that Satan has sons like God has sons? Do you realize that? There are people that he energizes just like Christ energizes some people more than other people on planet Earth. Why? Because of this quote-unquote angelic conflict. There's this battle going on. Okay? That's why when you pay attention to the fact that everybody says, well, the Antichrist has to be such and such. All right, now, who knows when Christ is coming back?
Only the Father.
Okay, now, that was only true while he was on planet Earth. He is now part of the program again. What does he know in heaven? He knows when he's coming back. But does anybody else? There is one good thing that the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit do exceedingly well. Anybody know what it is?
Keep a secret.
Okay? It doesn't bother them one bit to know something that nobody else knows.
You ready for this?
Yes, ma'am. Let her rip, boss.
Okay. I don't know what you called them, but...
Big boys?
Nia something. On the earth in those days. And also...
Oh, the Nephilim.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's called Nephilim.
Okay.
Yes.
And afterwards, when the sons of God came in... when the sons of God, that's what they're called.
Yes, ma'am.
Came in to the daughters of men, and they bore children to them.
There you go.
So right there.
So there's that was the shooting match that was going on back at the beginning of the world.
The story of Noah's Ark.
Prior, yeah.
We were following.
And here's the deal. You have to understand, if these people were in, you have to, I don't want to, hang on. Big bad guy. Okay? This big bad guy is an earth suit. Okay? This earth suit is indwelled by a demon. That's what makes the earth suit work badly. Okay? So if the giants die at any time, What happens to the demon?
Finds another place.
He has to go find another abode. All right? Henceforth, your stories out of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Not John. Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Where demons were displaced
into the pigs
on one occasion, and they didn't find a home out there, and the man that were dispelled of the demons did not fill his head with Jesus Christ, so they came back to him 7 times 7. So 7 demons left, if you want to use numbers, 49 came back. I'm thinking he had a couple of different personalities by the time that show was done. But here's what happened. So these guys die off.
Are you saying that the giant offspring were indwelled by demons?
Oh, yes, sir. I don't doubt that for one second.
That's why God had to wipe everybody out, because the genome was corrupted.
Correct. And what does he do now with these guys that had this power? They're always looking for that son of Satan to get a new command. Go indwell this one. I need George Soros to have an entity in him to be a twisted, sick individual. Oh, pick me. And that's when they go to do their job. People don't seem to realize, if you don't understand anything else out of this book you're learning, if you do not serve Jesus Christ and Him crucified, you are serving Satan and his minions. There is no fence row. Okay? I'm sorry, there isn't. And we get into chapter 2, you're going to see it even more clearly, because moral people and Jews with the law were the same garbage bunch of people. Okay? So just understand that. So that's what was taking place with all of this stuff. And the Creator always gives, you know, he's looking over the whole thing, sees the plan, knows what he's doing to square it away, and he'll go about doing it. So you just need to realize, that's why I say, you don't seem to realize how protected you are by having an indwelling Holy Spirit. You can be niggled on the edges by something. You know, he can go by and go like this. The demon can. But if Ken doesn't entertain any of the stuff that was bumped off on him, do you ever pray after you shake anybody's hand? I'm sorry, I do. If I shake somebody's hand, which is, I'm going with Howie on this one, where you just bump fists, that's enough contact as I can. All right. But when I feel an impression of something odd, I go right to the big boy. I don't know what I just encountered, but it is not of you. I don't want anything to do with it. I don't want to have any influence over me. I don't want it entering my mind. I don't want it going home with me. I don't want it crossing the bridge. I don't want it doing anything.
And there are some people that can make your hair stand up.
And I don't have a lot to stand up, but it'll do it. All right? You understand what I'm saying? So here's the deal. This battle's going on, and they're aware of it, and they know the rules. You don't. Read the book. You'll find the rules. And that's what he's talking about here. So, at the end of the millennium, millions of people are revolting. The next part is, the creature is the central antagonist of the angelic conflict. And the creature is great, mega organizational abilities and administrative geniuses. How many of you, we've talked about this before, do you realize you've been profiled by Satan and his demons? How do you...
He knows all the buttons to push.
Yeah, exactly. He does. He knows everything about you. He knows what ticks you off. He knows what makes you happy. He knows what can run you down. He knows what can bring you up. He can do all that kind of stuff. And it's not like you have to listen to it.
But he knows.
How many of you have ever washed the car, okay, and you've taken the hose and you've pulled the handle on the hose and it doesn't work for a split second? And you turn around and look at it.
No.
All right? And by then, the pressure of the water is about to destroy the lizard that's in the hose, and the water's coming out. You're going to get splashed. That's exactly how he is. You'll get into a situation, and he'll work it all around, and you'll say, well, thank God, this is kind of weird. You'll step in a little closer to look, and boom, it hits you. Okay? He knows how to do that with his abilities. Got minions to be everywhere when he needs to be. Can't be everywhere at one time, but he knows what your plan is. Okay? That's why I say it's imperative for you to know that the blood of Christ is your brain coat, your helmet. Okay? Why? He can't read your mind, but he can sure take... How many of you have said, boy, if I ever get up there, I'm going to kick that guy's rear end so far, he's going to be able to count my toes out front. Maybe not like that, but you've said something similar to that. Who knows that? Who just heard that? So he's going to put as many people in front of me to garner that response, to break down my joy, and to get in front of me that he can possibly do. So what do I have to do? Stop that.
Put on the whole armor.
Yeah. Okay? When you see you're getting into a battle, how many of you take the bullets out of your gun? Anybody with any brains? No. Matter of fact, you make sure you got the straps all full and you got this one gun and all the projectiles around there, and you know, you make sure you got... How many times... Anybody ever wonder why a cowboy always opens the little thingamajigger on his gun and spins the chamber before he takes off into the big battle with the bad guy with the black hat? I could never figure that out. I figured, look, you're the guy that put six projectiles in there. How come you're wondering whether there's six in there this time? I think it's just a, kind of like a safety feature. I think he just wants to reassure himself that he's actually got something to go into. You need to do the same thing. You need to be aware of what you have. You flip your chamber over and you got what verses? Any verse you want. They're all around the perimeter. They're right there. And they'll shoot out in a heartbeat.
And the shield's only on the front. Don't be going the other way.
Yeah. Yeah, don't back up. Don't be backing up. That's not a good thing. Don't back up. All right. Now, flip the page here. Yes, ma'am.
Sometimes the Lord leads us to talk to somebody, and it's a conversation that has to happen for whatever reason. The person's having trouble. You know, he just says, go talk to this person.
Right.
And we don't want to be afraid to say something for fear that Satan's going to use it against us and whatever. So we can protect ourselves. I mean, ask the Lord.
Oh, yeah, you can.
Place a protective hedge around the conversation.
Sure.
So that demons can't hear it.
Sure.
I mean, there's ways to deal with it. It's not just don't ever say anything because somebody might hear something. You know. But
how many times do you sit down and study your Bible and you have every interruption that could possibly come across the table? How many of you think about that before you start and you pray that that does not happen? I do that more and more and more. I like to have that train of thought be on the tracks. I don't like it going off on a sidetrack because somebody calls. I understand people do have to call at a certain time, but I'm just telling you, pay attention. You're in a battle. You studying that book, what happens when Batman is needed? What does he shine into the sky? See? The bat signal. Okay, everybody knows that. All right, now I need you to understand something. The moment you open your Bible, the moment, what is being sent off into another realm?
The light?
The light of Jesus Christ. Okay? And who's he going to? I'm shining it because I said, look, I need the Holy Spirit here. I need him to work with me. I need him to open my eyes. I need him to open my heart. Who else sees the light?
The enemy.
Satan. So what's he saying? Demon 6, 8, and 10? Would you get over there and make about 14 phone calls in like 2 minutes? Who can interrupt that? Holy Spirit can interrupt that. Please understand that. That's part of your program. You're allowed to do that. Okay? And in doing so, all you're doing is kind of sequestering yourself inside the little bubble so that you can study unhindered. There are a lot of things that come to light in my mind when I go about it that way instead of, because it kind of focuses you on what you're doing. It allows you to get to be where you need to be, and that's in the scripture. I want his thoughts. I want the Holy Spirit's thoughts to permeate my mind when I'm studying. So that when I'm studying something and I need A and B to come out with a C, that's how I look at, as it starts rolling out. It's so much fun. Okay? That's why I said, as I'm studying this second chapter, which is more intense than this one, it is amazing what he has given us for information in 29 verses of a book. He's done so much to put it together for you and I that we're foolish not to pick it up and use it. Okay? That's why I said, you know, you don't think about the fact that markers on you. Well, that was tuckering out. There's two words right there out of chapter 2. It can totally revolutionize the way you look at somebody that does not know Jesus Christ, and whether or not you know Jesus Christ, and whether or not that individual on the other side of the fence knows Jesus Christ, whether he be saved or unsaved, because of those two words. And that's verse 11 and 12. And I need you to understand something. When he puts something in there like that, you know the only people that get that information are people that are maturing in Jesus Christ, because you're the only ones that can handle that kind of information. Okay? And the information that he puts out right there tells you what you have in that right there. Amazing stuff that you wouldn't see unless you sat down long enough to look for it, or you were allowed to be somewhere where you ended up getting the information. I get it from people that they got it from wherever they got it. But the thing of it is it's there for you. It's just not put out there as much anymore. It's not important for whatever reason, but it ain't out there. All right, 9. The creature has very bad habits. We can all establish that, right? He is a murderer from the beginning, which is in John 8:44, antagonistic to doctrine throughout history. Anytime you study the book, you're going to get on Satan's 10 most wanted list. If you apply the book, you're on the top 5. If you live in your position, you're the first thing he wants to take down, is get you out of your position, because you have authority and you have power that is indescribable to him. He would love to have it.
Yeah, but if you go to the next step, you have the ability to stop him. Because otherwise, you're just a target with no power.
And if you
realize that you've got the power, then there's no problem.
That's fine. But the thing of it is if I'm in my position, I don't have to worry about stopping him. He doesn't want to be around me. He's welcome to throw junk in my path, but he does not want to be around me. You know how I know that? Get around somebody that's an atheist and start talking about Jesus Christ. What do they want to do?
Flee.
I'm sorry. You are a giant conscience the moment you start talking to an individual like that. Or somebody that says, well, I'm mad at God. I say, okay, I'm going to stay away from you. Okay? That's not a good scenario. But here's the deal. We'll just keep going. Creature, it talks about here, it's enemy of the royal family. That's you. Okay? You and he don't get together for Christmas. Okay? Just don't. 10. Creature is the ruler of this world. Since the fall of man, the creature has been the ruler. Okay? There's the verses that will tell you that. But being the ruler does not mean he controls history. You're working for the guy that controls history. That's you. Something went away? That's you. You're working for Jesus Christ, and he's the one that controls history. So that's automatically going to set up a conflict. All right? He can only control those in history that are in the status of reversionism. And I put maladjusted. Okay? Anybody that is not focused on Christ is his to work with, be it Christian or not. That's what people don't. There's a lot of people that have that, what do they call that? Sovereignty of God. Look at the Bible, where God doesn't allow a Christian to ever get into that kind of a scenario. They don't think, that's a lot of people that think you can. Anybody here ever heard that you can't backslide? There are people out there that peddle that you know Christ, but you're not functioning for Christ, but you actually do know him. Okay? So you pay attention to some of these things, because that's not what this book says. The whole book of the first two chapters of, well, three chapters, first chapter 2 and 3 of Revelation tells you of churches that have problems. They are functional Christian churches with functional human problems that have to do with backing out of a contract they made with Jesus Christ. Okay? All right. Excuse me. Jesus Christ controls history. Therefore, the creature has to have a strategy in order to get into history at all. Okay? That's why I say, Satan is exceedingly intelligent. Okay? He is a phenomenal tactician. Knowing where to put his guys when you need to put your guys where you need to put them. Alright? He has a strategy regarding the nations of the world. Number one, and that strategy is conceit. If you pay attention to American history, we didn't used to think that we had to impose what we had on everybody else. We would go help. But we've gotten a little bit puffy around the edges that way. Number two, deceit. Make something look different than what it really is. Okay? You can, any kind of advertisement on TV, you can pretty well that it doesn't usually live up to the standards of the advertisement. Not always, but enough times. And then the last part of the program is conspiracy. Now, here's a weird one, because this is a conspiracy that is against God. Your life's going to be miserable on planet Earth if you know Jesus Christ. Just in case you want to know. Okay? Work with that. Alright? Let that stew around and work around the edges. That's all he has to say. Then your mind will take care of it the rest of the way. By the way, that's not true. Just in case you want to know. Okay? Here's the deal. He can work that program again and again and again with every single individual. And you know what he works around? That right there. Rights. That guy didn't have it. There was no reason for that man to do that to you. Now what did Jesus Christ, tell you about every scenario in your life? Everything he puts you through is to mature you in Jesus Christ so that it can glorify the Father. Everything. Now what did he say? He's going to make almost everything work together for those that, what do they do? What do you have to do to get that program started?
All things work together for good for those that love the Lord.
All love the Lord.
According to His purpose.
Isn't that nice?
All
things. Oh, is that what it says?
All things.
Oh. Well, he's going to change a couple words for you. And here's the deal. You have to realize that. How many of you think bad scenarios...
So you're saying that the bad stuff comes from God too?
Nope.
How about if the bad stuff all comes from the devil, the good stuff all comes from God?
Yep.
And when there's a difference between bad stuff at you, God turns it for good.
Casting isn't always good.
Hang on.
It's almost always bad.
What?
And that comes from God.
Hang on. What?
Testing. Testing will come from God.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Sending, allowing.
Do you have any other examples of testing besides Job?
Okay, hang on. There you go.
Anybody, any Christian's life.
Yeah, any Christian. Now, here's the deal. Sometimes God will send testing. He is not going to send it in the form of a sin. Okay? He can't corrupt his essence. Got that? So what is he going to do? He might allow you to walk into a situation. Now, what's he depending on you? Somewhere along the line, you have to grow up. Everybody's out of diapers in here. I better not go there. Okay. Almost everybody, most people are out of diapers anymore, okay? All right? Why did you break away from the diaper thing? Right at the beginning of the shooting match. You grew up, you matured, you learned to use the porcelain God, right? Okay, there you go. Alright, just so you know. So here's the deal. The same thing is expected of you in Christ. He does not expect you to be ga-ga-ga, boo-boo, blah-blah-blah, all that for forever. You're maturing, and as you mature, you're going to get into scenarios that are going to show you that you've matured, or they are going to mature you because you are in the scenario. Okay? That's what he's talking about here. That's what he's talking about here. That's why Satan is always, he'd love to get under your skin, but if you don't let him, the beneficial program is that you're going to mature in Christ because you're going to see that scenario. Can you probably sit down somewhere and probably put 100 top 10 things Satan wants to do? I mean, his program. Power, lust, all the things. You can probably put a list. He doesn't have any new ones on the list. Whatever he used in the garden is the same hook he used on Jesus on the Temple Mount. On the top of the temple. Same thing. Alright? So he doesn't have any new junk. So you're going to recognize it. How many of you recognize a problem on the highway ahead of you as you're driving down the road? Why do you recognize it?
You're watching for it.
You're watching for it. Now how do you know you're watching for it if you never saw it before? You can't. How do you try to teach your kids to drive?
Cautiously.
You know what my dad always told us? Never pay attention to the car in front of you. Pay attention to the car two or three or four in front of you. And I'm going, well, dang, that guy's not in front of me. Those guys up there, this guy's right in front of me. He said, just listen, son, you know, do what I say and it'll work. And honest to goodness. You see a set of lights four or five cars up. What do? You're prepping. You're taking your foot off the gas, looking for somewhere to go. Well, same exact thing with your Christianity. You're going to see these scenarios again and again and again and again. Okay? And as you do, they're going to come into a category for you. You're going to know exactly what to pull off the shelf to do whooping against them. That's all there is to it. Your kid comes home and says, you know, I really screwed up my classes in college. What were you doing? And I said, well, you know, well, we were out a little too late on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. But Saturday, we really buckled down. So next time you come in and they start whipping out, you, whoa, 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 we've been down this road before. Let me show you the outcome last time. You were here crying because you blew it on a class. So let's not do the same thing again. No different. It's exactly how your Christianity works. You might be blessed to have people around you that can help you when those scenarios show up, but you always have Christ with you when they show up. You always have an indwelling spirit. Never get away from that, okay? All right. Here we go. What's the page here? Creature is the chief opponent to the law of divine establishment, antagonistic towards human freedom, of course, and anti-doctrine to the core. Divine establishment, that's the laws that God set up. He tells you that up is down and down is up. Who do you go with? I'm going with God. I know down's down. If you don't trust him, get out there, go up to the top, right there by the cross on the front porch of the church, and jump off. Okay? If you go up, then I have to get rid of my Bible. But I'm pretty sure you're going to put a big old grease spot on that front porch over there, and everything's going to be fine. Not with you, but everything's fine on my list. Okay? Just so you understand what they're talking about here. Now, he has strategy regarding the unbelievers of the world. It runs the gamut, maneuvering for advantage of blindness of the soul, which we'll talk about, scar tissue of the soul, which we'll talk about, reverse process reversionism. This is when you go from scar tissue to evil. Okay? How many of you usually keep your sins covered up? You're legit. It's in your, you know. Don't anybody in here doesn't sin?
We don't advertise them.
Well, okay, there you go. That's what I'm talking about. There you go. You're safe. Okay. We won't say anything. Okay.
Good.
All right. But the deal is with all of this, he doesn't want that case to be done. He wants to be able to, not only you cover them up, you go beyond that. You get so arrogant, you don't even care if you're... Bill Clinton was a good example of that. He went from scar tissue to open evil. Why? Because he felt secure in the position he was in. Okay? That is what the Bible, again and again, calls self-righteousness. Understand it. It's going to be a bane to the human existence. All right? So that's what they're talking. I'm almost done here. I have to be almost done. Of all of this, the possible is possible because of negative volition and God consciousness. We already put that together. You have God consciousness, then you have gospel hearing, and then you have in Christ. And between the two, gospel of consciousness of God and gospel hearing, where you put the two together, there's a window of time. And that's what they're talking about here. He likes to get in between. You know the road that they write of in the Bible where the seed is cast? Some of it falls on rocks and some of it falls on some kind of soil. And every now and again, some of it hits good soil, puts down good roots and springs up. That's what they're talking about here. That's that window between somebody being aware of God, you having a God consciousness, and having a little entertainment center with the Holy Spirit on it, presenting the gospel to you. And that little window is when a lot of times when a Christian can be waylaid. They can get false doctrine, they can walk into cults, they can do all kinds of weird things. All right? Just so you're aware of what he's trying to talk about here. Now, negative volition and gospel hearing on part of the believer. The unbeliever who is maladjusted to the justice of God is in a status of reversionism or rebellion, which is what you and I would call it, and is completely under the control of Satan. All right? In addition to this, every born again believer, negative towards doctrine. How many times have you been a Christian and you're going to tell them what to say and they say, "Don't tell me what the Bible says about it." Have you heard that a couple times? I have. I said, "Well, then, by golly, I'm pretty well this sure this conversation's over." Because you don't want to hear it. If you don't want to hear it, you're going down a road that he's going to rearrange your program in a heartbeat here, so don't worry about it. Let me finish this here. And it says, under the same control of Satan. You don't seem to realize. You stop going positive to doctrine, Satan can come and niggle on the edges of your life. And he will do it. You're a good target. You're already in a state of turmoil, and you don't know, you know, you're not thinking clearly, and that's the problem, the difference. The believer in this state cannot be demon-possessed. Okay? You can't have two residences in one soul. Well, you can, but that's weird personalities, okay? So,
isn't that kind of like the house divided against itself?
There you go. Okay, so that doesn't wash. And those are markers along the way. You'll notice things that people do. And then when it says, only under demon influence. You need to understand something. Demon influence to you can be as something as little as you having a thought that you've allowed to entertain because of something you read or something you heard or whatever. It could be something as small as that because it'll start you on a path of doubting what you have. That's when you start having a problem. And if you knew how many times your mind has said, "Well, I just don't think God can handle this," you have done nothing but put a great big old honking sign in front of your safe, say, "Open for business. Any demon that wants to come and screw up my head right now, you're welcome to it until I get back on the reservation." That's all you're saying.
That's good to me.
Yeah.
There's nothing.
Yeah, there you go.
With
that's
the Lord.
Exactly right. So that's the deal, okay? So here you go. It says, if the gospel be hid, it is hid to those who are lost. So that eliminates anybody that has any inkling of Jesus Christ or has any entertainment with Jesus Christ. You have the gospel, you have the doctrine, and you cannot, it cannot be hidden from you. It can only be obscured from you. Alright? How many have clear glass on your front door? If you have a front door. Everybody's got a front door? Okay. How many of you have clear glass? Okay. How many of you have kind of smoky, opaque? Okay. That's the deal. Clear glass is when you're seeing everything exactly the way it is. If you're off the reservation every now and again, the glass is going to cloud up because you're not going to be able to see things exactly the way you want. You need to go get the Windex, clean that rascal up, or whatever you have to do to get the garbage off of it so that you can see clearly what he wants you to see. That's basically what it amounts to. Well, I'm not telling you don't have to go change your door, okay? All right, it's something to show you. All right, here we go. Myra, Lissa, Melissa, Jennifer, Pam, Ken, Ralph, and Amy, all of them on the cancer list. Some of them are remission, some of them don't, some of them wrestling with it. Church staff and service, military men and women, folks that we haven't seen. If you see anybody, run into them, give them a holler, I'll call some. My brother's wife passed away Friday. Okay, well, she was in bad shape, but just pray for the family. Pray for the daughters. One of them's really having a tough time. She was really, really close to her mom. So just do that and pray for Rick. Sometimes he's a little phlegmatic. So just keep him in your prayers and let him get through everything. And we'll go from there, see what happens. Marianne, Len having laser surgery on his eye Wednesday. Which one? You see me? Okay. That one? All right. What are they going to fix astigmatism?
No, the lens is it's not a cataract. It's not a lens replaced already.
Oh, they're just going to clear it up?
Yeah, there's a membrane in the back of the lens.
Yeah, they told me that happens sometimes.
Yeah, but he's already had that.
Oh. Hey, what are you going to do? Just keep working with it. Okay? Where am I out here? Melissa? Young lady needs guidance in her life. Tom and Barbara, Donna in Colorado with 3M situation. 3M, okay. All right, that's code. Okay, that's God code. John, unspoken. David, co-worker, wife Amy with pancreatic cancer. That's not a good one. That's somebody you know. Okay. Tom and Edith, 3 different individual organizations are potentially interested in the building up there. Keep praying. Okay. Lois, pray for Tina from Harbor Town Marina. She's having complications in her battle with cancer. Mom has a sore in her leg, which is having a problem healing. Man. Michelle Williams, mom having knee surgery this week in Syracuse. And Joy, health issues, pneumonia, bronchitis, lung problems, etc. Healing, daughter, Gidget, gallbladder out and healing. All right. Busy day. Here you go, sire. All right. Let's pray and I'll turn you loose. Thank you, Lord, for today. Thank you for the option we have that we can figure out what this creature is that we're doing battle with. And we give him the gravity he needs, but it's not overarching. You belong to the program that wins everything. And we're under your tutelage. Allow us to learn what we need to learn. Allow us to apply what we need to apply. Allow us to leave this room with an attitude that can only be presented by the Holy Spirit through you to us. We ask these things in Christ's name.